So that automatically, subconsciously will inform your work. It's bound to. And that might come through. So a message might be conveyed because of that.
Right.
But the message is not the intention. The intention is to touch hearts. The intention is to talk about human beings.
That you very much do. That you very much do. I still remember the day I saw Mr. and Mrs. I was like bowled over. I was mesmerized to think the level of intelligence a director shares on screen, and you know, gets the point delivered to the audience. It was wonderful, ma'am. Now, talking about Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, you said the violence, the riot, which was plaguing our society at that point in time. I think it was a very subtle representation of that point, the society of that point. Was that intentional as well?
Well, of course, I was making a story of the present times, and in a bus, you often find a cross-section of people that are representative of the different ethnicities that exist in India. So a bus becomes a kind of mini India.
Okay.
That was definitely intentional, because I feel that that often happens. In fact, in the bus, the majority were Hindus, there was one Muslim couple, there was one Jewish man. So it was like it is in society today.
No, but as a director, would you mind taking risk of showing such a strong subject? Would you mind delving into such a strong subject?
I have to tell you that I don't consider it a risk.
You don't consider it a risk? Directors do it.
Well, I do. I think they just frighten people.
And I think that
confidence I get because of my confidence in the intelligence of the audience. Okay. I don't think of the audience as a bunch of fools. I think of the audience as somebody who is my equal. And I will not disrespect the audience by trying to feed them stuff that, you know, they will easily understand. Of course, I'm not going to kind of, go over their heads and, indulge in intellectual stuff that nobody will understand. This is not a poem that I'm writing. It is not that personal. Of course, I also believe that there can be intensely personal films. Mm-hmm. And as the technical technology, as it is advancing more and more, filmmaking, because of the digital media, is becoming cheaper and cheaper. And at some stage, there will be entirely personal films, small films, haiku films, all kinds of cinema will coexist. And that is the operative word, coexistence. I believe, let 100 flowers bloom, let 100 films bloom, let 100 different kinds of films bloom, let there be commercial cinema which will employ a lot of people, let there be artistic cinema that will appeal to the minds of people who are inclined that way, let there be intensely personal films that will speak only to a few, let there be all kinds of cinema. Why should there be only one kind?
Level of intelligence of the audience has changed
lot. No, I think the audience has always been intelligent.
Always been intelligent?
Yes, I think the audience has always been intelligent. It's just that because they want to reach the lowest common denominator, they're appealing to that. So they have been giving the audience things that they think the audience will like. And they are right in the sense that there are elements in that which the audience likes. But it is not that the audience entirely likes everything that is dished out in, formula films. But what choice does the audience have? From childhood, they're being fed on this fare. Have they ever been given a choice? I mean, if you're thinking of the other kind of cinema, alternative cinema, parallel cinema, whatever you call it, have the audience, members of the audience from childhood, had exposure to that kind of cinema that they will enjoy that kind of cinema? Only once in a while do they get to see that kind of cinema.
Right. I think before you and Mr. Rituponno Ghosh, there was a trend and a signature style of Mr. Satyajit Ray.
The kind of movies, Benegal.
Shyam Benegal, the kind of movies they have been dished out by them. I think that has catered to the to that particular taste bud of the audience. But again, that was ignored for long.
No, it's a minority, but that minority can grow. But the problem is that people don't get to see that kind of cinema. Earlier on, at least in Doordarshan, films that used to win national awards, regional films, would always be showcased on Doordarshan. Now even that has stopped. So everything is geared towards mainstream Hindi cinema.
Okay.
So how will they get to see these films? I've been, I think for the last 30 years, I've been talking about film, introducing film as a, subject in the curriculum, in schools, because I think that is a very, very relevant thing today. But nothing, of course, has been done.
Unfortunately. It's only, media studies students in the post-graduation.
By that time, their minds have been formed, their tastes have been formed.
Do you think as a director, you have been able to change that trend?
I don't think that as a director, you can change. But yes, I think that I am very fortunate in that I have a small but very loyal following among the audience who wait for my films. I can tell that from Facebook. Thank you so much. I can tell that from Facebook. For instance, they're waiting for my films.
Okay. Now getting back to Ithri Mrinalini once again. Okay. Many said it's a movie depicting your life.
Yes, I knew when we were writing the script at that time. I thought, oh my God, about this film, there's going to be very sort of voyeuristic inquisitiveness about that. Well, she is very much me. Her mental makeup is very much that of mine. But the events in her life are not historically those of mine.
Okay.
So you can't really, if you're looking for events that will match events in my life with slightly disguised names, that is not
the case. That is not the case. But while you were scripting down your movie, when you were,
laughing.
You were laughing?
We were laughing and saying, oh God, this is how the media is going to project this, or people are going to think, all right, I smell a scandal.
But did you go nostalgic while writing your story?
Yes, to some extent, of course. Especially when I was writing about Mrinalini's college days, which were my college days too.
Right. The movie shows a level of frustration in the glamour industry. A sort of frustration. Do you buy that? Do you agree to that? Is it there?
There is a lot of heartache. People get disappointed. Their hopes are dashed. Ambitions are foiled. Dreams are destroyed. All that happens, of course. Like anywhere else, like any other industry, the film industry is no exception. There is competitiveness. There is, backbiting. There is...
No, many say because as an actor you wear a lot of makeup, somehow the dark circles under your eyes, they are overshadowed, and the real self of you is like somewhere cornered. Is it true?
No. What I had actually said about this, which is probably what you've read, is that within the community, within the film community, among the technicians and the actors and so on, there is a bond, of companionship. Actors have their personal lives. They're not always happy in their personal lives. Sometimes you will go to the set and you've been through a storm in your personal life, and you probably haven't slept the night. And in fact, Shirley MacLaine had written about it in her book Don't Fall Off the Mountain. In her autobiography, she had written that, and you come, you've got dark circles under your eyes, you've had a bad night, but nobody asks any questions. It's a sympathetic silence.
Okay.
You don't even want to talk about it, so nobody will ask any questions. Quietly, the light men will bring out more lights and fill the shadows under your eyes so that you still look glamorous. You still look the way you're supposed to. And that understanding, that bond of sympathy is what binds people in the film industry together. There is a great companionship also. Along with betrayal and backstabbing and all that, there is also a deep bond of understanding.
So all that you read in page 3 is all that not true?
I don't read page 3, so I don't know.
Okay. Coming to the end of the show, from lights, camera and action, are you taking a break at this point while you're thinking about another story?
Yeah.
Okay. And will it be another on Konkona once again?
I don't know. I really don't know, and I don't like talking about my future ventures because plans keep getting foiled.
Okay.
You plan on doing something. I was planning on doing Goinar Baksho for the longest time, and instead I made Iti Minale. I was going to do Goinar Baksho. It didn't happen. I made Mr. and Mrs. Iyer. Then I was going to do Goinar Baksho. That didn't happen. Then I made 15 Paakar. Then I was going to do Goinar Baksho. Again, it didn't happen, and I made The Japanese Wife. Again, I tried Goinar Baksho. Didn't happen. Again, and then I made Iti Mrinalini. Maybe I'll try Goinar Baksho once more. Maybe it will happen.
I'll wait for that. But tell me something. Is Konkona is always your first choice?
No.
Or you not go by the demand of the script?
Yeah, the story tells me. I'm a director first.
Okay.
I mean, when I'm directing, when I'm planning a film, I'm a director first, not a mother first. So I'm always the mother. That's there. That is there. My affection for my daughters are always there. Is always there. But when I'm directing, I won't think that, oh, for instance, I wouldn't have cast Konkona in The Japanese Wife.
Okay.
I cast Raima.
Okay.
Because I felt that Konkona's personality is very, very strong.
Very strong.
And I didn't want that.
Okay. And I forgot to ask, how is the baby?
Oh, he's fine. He's a joy. All
right.
He's a bundle of joy, yes.
All right. It's only been 2 days Iti Mrinalini has released. It's doing wonderful, right? And I wish you all the very best for the success of the movie. চোখের পাতায় পাতার চোখেতে দারুণ জল ছবি মায়া মায়া ভোর ঘুম ভেঙে যায় সকাল সোনায় হঠাৎ ভৈরবী. Hopefully you'll catch up once again post success celebration, right?
Well, again, inshallah.
I'll keep my fingers crossed.
All right.
All right. Thank you for watching, friends, and hope to give you more of Miss Sen very soon.